Sometime back this year, I came across John 12, and from time to time, a passage of Scripture that I've known for years and years just jumps out at me and says, "Preach me, preach me." I don't know why that is. I've had that happen a number of times. And in John chapter 12, the lesson really tonight is entitled, "The Unbelief of the Jewish People," or as our title and our announcement, just the unbelief of John chapter 12, because even though in this chapter it's dealing with the Jewish people who were with Jesus Christ and around him while he was upon the earth, the things that caused them not to believe in Jesus or to waver in their faith are the same then as they are today. And so it's easy to make an application, because we might ask ourselves, why do people not believe the gospel? Why do they not obey the gospel? Or why do they have a very superficial faith in the Bible or in God? And this chapter tells us a lot of reasons why that is. And it's interesting, because I'm pretty sure by inspiration, the Holy Spirit guided John to point that out in this chapter. There's other lessons too, but this one, as I've said, just kind of jumps out at me. Well, if we start in chapter 12 and verse 1, let me begin there by reading verse 1 and through about verse 6. 6 days before the Passover, this is Jesus' final entry into Jerusalem, where he's going to be crucified. It said, "Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead." I find that's quite interesting. You don't have too many times anywhere that somebody says, "Well, I was over to Bob's house, who was dead." That'd be a strange thing to hear, wouldn't it? But that's true of Lazarus. Jesus had raised him from the dead. In verse 2, "There they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil." And authorities tell us that the amount of oil being used here was about a year's salary for the average Jewish person. So a very expensive gift that she gives to Jesus. She wipes his feet with her hair. The house is filled with the fragrance. But one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, "Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box and used to take what was put in it. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. She has kept this for the day of my burial. For the poor you will always have with you, but me you do not always have." Judas was a thief. He was chosen by the Lord as one of the 12 apostles, but Jesus knew from the beginning that he was going to betray him. And the reason why is because Judas could not believe as he should because of his tremendous covetousness. Jesus warned all of us in the Gospel of Luke when he said, "Take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life does not consist in the abundance of the things which he possesses." And that strikes me as interesting, because in America, if we have anything, we have an abundance of things. But you've never seen a hearse go down the highway with a U-Haul on the back end, have you? We don't take any of it with us. We brought nothing into this world. It's certain we can take nothing out. And yet we spend all of our lifetime gathering and accumulating and wanting more and more and more. And to some degree, that's okay. But when it becomes the goal of your life, like it was for Judas, and you become a covetous person, where you will steal and rob and take and look for ways to scheme and plot to take away what others have to make it for yourself, you become a very, very poor human being, as Judas was. He had a very shallow faith in Jesus Christ, and when he saw the wonderful gift that Mary had bestowed upon Jesus, all he could think of is, that cost too much. He missed the whole lesson. She was honoring Jesus before his death. She had a deeper understanding of what Jesus was all about, and Mary was appreciative of the fact that her brother Lazarus had been raised from the dead. She could not do enough for Jesus. But keep in mind that his sin-sick soul would not allow the entrance of God's word into his heart, because Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall be filled with the word of God. They shall be given the truth of God's word." And Judas doesn't have this poorness of spirit, this emptiness of heart where Christ can come in and fill his soul. But rather you look into the soul of Judas and you see money, 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 greed, greed, greed. And the Bible says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Jesus also said that a man who loves money or a man who trusts in money is one who cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. We must trust in God and lean on him every day of our lives because he provides what we have. And by his goodness and by his grace and by his providence, which he gives to us every day, we have what we have. But if you and I begin to think like the world, that we've got to run out and grab all we can as fast as we can, any way that we can, then we become very poor in spirit. So lesson number one is, sin-sick souls cannot believe as they should. Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. And covetousness is one sin. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, the pride of life, those are other sins that can inhabit our soul and keep God's word out as well. But here is Judas, who has a bird's eye view of the life of Jesus Christ, spends 3 years with him, and at the end of that time, he simply betrays Jesus for what? 30 pieces of silver. How in the world could you do that to the Son of God? A second lesson we learn is, if you'll notice, there were a bunch of thrill seekers hanging around as well. Look at verse 12. Now, great many of the Jews knew that Jesus was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. And I call these people thrill seekers because they're just interested in the excitement. And I understand that when miracles are worked, there's an element that involves that, because as you're well aware, the different terms for a miracle are the miracles, signs, and what's the third word? Wonder. Wonder is the reaction of someone who sees a true miracle. So these people had heard that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, and they wanted to see Lazarus because they probably knew him. They'd probably seen him. He was a very well-known figure in the realm of Jerusalem and Judea, and so they wanted to see for themselves, what does it look like to see a man who was dead for 3 days raised again? But I also think that they were very shallow in their faith, because even though the miracle was a sign from God to testify that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, it seems like they're more interested in seeing the evidence or the miracle itself than to think about what they should believe because of it. So sometimes they see the miracle and miss the message. Truly, many other signs Jesus did in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Don't miss the message of the miracle. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead right in Judea, right in the midst of Jerusalem, right in the hotbed of his worst enemies, who now were plotting to kill him. And right in their face, he says, "Look what I can do." He raised Lazarus from the dead to cause all in Jerusalem and Bethany to believe in Jesus. And that was one of the miracles that got him finally crucified. Jesus knew exactly what their reaction would be. So when you study the miracles of Jesus, don't stop and think, "Well, now how could he do that? How could he turn water into wine? Just exactly how do you turn the loaves and fishes into enough to feed thousands of people?" All of those things are wonderful. And I've had people say, and I don't hear it so much anymore, but I used to hear when I first began preaching, people say, "Well, if we just had miracles today, a lot more people would believe." Really? Do you think that? If so, pay attention to this chapter, because Jesus worked many miracles. Didn't do them a bit of good. They would not believe. Why? It's a heart issue. It's not a lack of evidence. And when Paul said in Romans 1:16, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God That's what that is. It's the dynamite of God that will blast into a heart. And if that heart can be moved, it will be moved by the message of the gospel, not by the miracles that were worked to confirm the message. Even those who saw the miracles of Jesus and the apostles had to stop and think, now what does this mean for me? You remember John chapter 6, Jesus finally stopped working the miracle of feeding the 5,000, the 4,000, because they were following him, as he said, not because you saw the miracles and believed, but because you were filled with the loaves and wanted another free meal. Don't labor for the meat which perishes. Labor for the food which endures in everlasting life. But many walk back never to be with Jesus again. If we don't get our free meal, we're done. How shallow is that? And so keep in mind why these miracles were worked. And in John chapter 12, verses 17 and 18, commenting on that, it says, therefore the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of his tomb and raised him from the dead bore witness. For this reason the people also met him, because they heard that he had done this sign. Now let's think about the testimony, the evidence, the witnessing to the miracles of Jesus Christ. Today we don't see those miracles, but we have a biblical evidence of these miracles. We have a testimony of the eyewitnesses who saw it. So really the belief in these miracles of Jesus, the belief that Jesus is the Son of God, is based on the credibility of these witnesses. And sometimes people say, well, if I can't experience it with my five senses, then I'm not going to believe it. But they don't do that in every other walk of life. None of us do. The perfect example is, I've been on a jury before. Any of you ever been on a jury? You go to a trial and they're trying to convict a man of a certain crime, and the people who are on the jury did not see the crime. They didn't taste it, touch it, feel it, see it, or experience it in any way with their five senses. But they're being asked to determine that man's future based on his guilt or innocence. And you know what they use? They use evidence to prove their point. Even if you've never been on a jury, you've seen the detective shows and the courtroom shows, and they're always pointing out the evidence. Well, when you're in the jury box, and I've been outside the jury box before, and I thought, well, if I were on that jury, I'd hang that fellow as fast as I could. But you know what? When all of a sudden the authority really rests on your shoulders and you're one of 12 that's going to determine that man's fate, it's a heavy pressure. Because the experience I had was, well, is he really guilty? Is he really innocent? And we have to listen to the evidence put forth and listen to the defense attorney to try to dispel the evidence. And then when the trial is over, the jury gets together in the jury room and they decide that man's fate. Well, it's not just a guessing game. You're trying to determine it based on facts. The Bible is the same way. When Thomas said, unless I see the nail prints in his hand and thrust my hand in his side, I will not be believing, Jesus Christ gave him that privilege of seeing him as an eyewitness resurrected person. But don't forget what Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. That's you and me. We believe because the Bible is a book of credible evidence, and the evidence is so overwhelming that we cannot but accept the fact that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that evidence is just as binding as it would be if it were presented in a courtroom by a lawyer. So don't let somebody tell you that Christians have a blind faith. Nothing could be further from the truth. The eyewitnesses confirmed the resurrection, and the worst enemies of Jesus could never dispel that, and we'll see that in a moment. But keep in mind that the miracles are not just for thrill-seeking. They're there to cause you and me to believe that God is in Jesus Christ. Well, here's a third problem. Some people have their heart filled with the devil. The chief priest of all people, in John chapter 12, verses 10 and 11, it says, the chief priest plotted, now watch this, to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him, many of the Jews went away and believed in Jesus. That was their reaction to the miracle of the resurrection of Lazarus from the dead. They didn't deny it. They said, let's just kill him and get rid of the evidence. Let's kill Jesus and get rid of him. You see, the miracle did not have the effect on their heart that it should have had because they're so full of the devil. And I don't think that's an exaggeration. I think Satan has entered their heart because they've left it open by their bitterness and by their hatred for Jesus Christ. And yet, ladies and gentlemen, these are you ready? These are religious leaders. We tend to think, well, if a guy is a preacher, he must be okay. Or if he's a religious leader in some church, he must be a good guy. Be careful. Be careful. Some of them are devil-filled, evil human beings who would kill you if they had the opportunity. And why are these men so opposed to Jesus? Because they're doing anything and going to any length to protect their station in life, to protect their prestige, or to protect their financial means, or to protect the power that they think they have over the people that Jesus is challenging them. Rather than accept the evidence of Lazarus' resurrection, they saw it as an obstacle to their own selfish ends. Very, very sick people think like that. And in verse 19, the Pharisees, who also were devil-filled, said, therefore among themselves, you see, you're accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after him. The Sadducees, the chief priests, they're trying to kill Jesus. Now they're going to kill Lazarus. The Pharisees want Jesus gone in any way necessary because that ruins their position. And so when men have the devil fill their hearts, they can do all kinds of evil things. And the devil can enter your heart if you give him a room. Resist the devil and he will what? Flee from you, James, the Lord's brother, said. What if I don't resist the devil? Then he's not going anywhere. He walks about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And once he's devoured your soul, he'll use you against Christ and Christianity today. How many Americans are devil-filled and never realize that that's really the problem? The irony is they say, well, I want to be my own person. I want to be my own man. I want to do my own thing. And yet they're being swayed by sin, so that sin and the devil is actually the ruler over their hearts. And if you don't think so, just ask yourself, is an alcoholic in charge of his life? Is a drug addict in charge of his life? Is a young man who is driven to pornography and he can't stop that addiction, is he in charge of his life? And the answer is no. He's a slave to sin and to the devil just as much as these Sadducees, chief priests, and Pharisees were. Be careful, ladies and gentlemen, how close you get to Satan, because you can certainly be burned by him. And never know it. Satan is deceptive. He'll make you think you're in charge while all the while destroying your soul. Do you think these Pharisees and chief priests and Sadducees thought they were doing the devil's work? Oh, no. We're protecting the nation of Israel from this fellow who we don't know where he came from. So how evil can some people be? You know, Emily and I have been married quite a long time. When we were young married couple, a few times she'd hear about somebody committing murder and you hear about the details. And as I've said already in the last couple of decades, I've heard more cases of children killing their parents or children killing their grandparents for whatever reason. Husbands killing their wives, wives killing their husbands. And Emily always used to comment on that and she'd say, you know, what happened to those people? Because they were born an innocent, loving baby. And you have to stop and ask yourself, what did happen between birth and their crime? And the answer is, they filled their hearts full with the devil. Well, here's another example of what can happen to people, and that is, there are some who would believe, but they are materialistic, earthbound. They see nothing past this life. And again, in John chapter 12, beginning at verse 12, it says, the next day a great multitude heard that Jesus had come to the feast, and when they heard that, they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, as is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. It always perturbed me to think that one day you have these people calling Jesus Christ the King of Israel and throwing these palm branches in front of him and giving him a great procession or parade down through the city of Jerusalem, and then they turn right around and they're part of the angry mob that crucifies him. I thought, what's going on? Well, what's going on is these people thought that Jesus Christ was an earthly king, a king like David who would resurrect Israel from the depths of their bondage to Rome and throw off the shackles of Roman power and make them a great empire once again. And they wanted that kind of a king. And that was true throughout Jesus' entire ministry. In John 6, it says in verse 15, when they came and tried to take Jesus by force to make him a king, Jesus departed into the desert place himself alone. And when Pilate asked him, "Are you a king?" he said, "For this cause I was born, and for this cause I came to the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who's of the truth hears my voice." Yes, Jesus is a king of truth, a king of a spiritual realm, a kingdom of another place, but not an earthly king like these people wanted. And so their materialistic, earthbound decisions and choices kept them from believing in Jesus as they ought to. And even his own disciples had a problem with that, as we see here in the text. It said they didn't understand what was going on when this happened at the beginning. And John gives us Psalm 118, 26 and verse 13, and also Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9 and verses 14 and 15. And Jesus knew he was a king, but of a spiritual realm. He said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were of this world, my servants would fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews, but now my kingdom's not from here." The disciples thought it was going to be from here too. After his death, burial, and resurrection, before he ascended to heaven, in Acts chapter 1, the 12 said, "Well, will you restore the kingdom of God to Israel now?" And Jesus said, "Just wait till you're endued with power from on high and you'll understand better." They certainly needed the direct operation of the Holy Spirit on their hearts for them to become the apostles God wanted them to be. The good news about this crowd is that this kind of unbelief was caused by an honest misunderstanding. That can be corrected because we all misunderstand things from time to time. And I often wonder how many of this crowd who first laid palm leaves before Jesus said, "The great King of Israel," and then participated in his death on the cross, then showed up on the day of Pentecost, and when they were convicted of their crime, repented and obeyed the gospel. I have to believe that of the 3,000, some of these people were there for that purpose. And as they learned more about the spiritual kingdom or the church and how Jesus was here to save us from sin, not Roman bondage, and that he was trying to make our lives and our souls better, not just for a little while, but for all time and eternity, that transition then began to take place. So as the man said one time to Jesus when he wanted him to heal his son, and he said, "Lord, if you can, and Jesus said, "If I can," and he fell down crying. He said, "Lord, I believe. Please help my unbelief." I say that myself all the time. Lord, help my unbelief. There's things I still don't know. There's things I still need to learn. And so do you. And so a materialistic, earthbound concept, and there's a lot of believers in God to this day, in Jesus Christ. They say the New Testament's true, but they are looking for an earthly king in Jerusalem for 1,000 years. How mistaken can they be? If they'll willingly study and listen to the scriptures, they'll find out that Jesus' kingdom is far greater than any earthly kingdom. So there's hope for this crowd. Then we have yet another one, which is very common among us today as well, and that is people who are there to please men. John 12:42 and 3 goes on to say, "Nevertheless, among the rulers. Many believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. Now that's a common problem. I remember years ago, a young lady came forward. She is a member of the church where I preached, and she came forward sobbing, and she was confessing her sins as a Christian who'd fallen away a little bit. And she told me, this has been going on for a long time. I said, Christy, why did you wait so long to come forward? She said, I was afraid of what everybody would think of me. I said, well, if they think anything of you except that you're a penitent child of God who wants to be right with the Lord, you let me know. And you know, brethren generally are not going to criticize, at least where I've been. They're going to wrap their arms around them and say, God bless you for having the courage to admit you're wrong, to have the ability and the humility to confess them and to be forgiven by the blood of Christ. But how many people will let their, well, what does everybody else think of me, determine whether they obey Jesus or not? If you have that problem, ladies and gentlemen, I suggest that you learn somehow to forget what anybody else may say or do, and you focus on what will Jesus think of you. If you'll think about what Jesus wants for you, then you'll believe in him, look to him, obey him, and follow him. And if men love it or don't love it, that doesn't matter. Wherever Jesus leads, there you will follow, because your heart is with him. And we all need that lesson from time to time, because peer pressure is a very real thing, whether you're in school or whether you're an adult or whether you work somewhere. How many times do we hesitate to invite somebody to a gospel meeting like this because we don't want to look like one of those religious fanatics? We don't want people to know that we're that sincere about Christianity. And again, I've run into people lots of times as a preacher, and I tell them I'm a gospel preacher, and they look at you like you have three eyeballs in your head. And I told one lady one time, she gave me that look, I said, you know what, I was raised on planet Earth just like you. She said, what? She was scared to death of me. I said, I don't know what you've seen before, but I said, I'm just a normal human being like you. It turned out she'd had a lot of bad experiences with denominational pastors who thought they were superior to everybody, and they looked down at her. And there's a lot of story to that. But at the time, I didn't know why she looked at me so strange. But you see, people worry about what other people think. And we can't do that and be faithful to the Lord. The Apostle Paul said in Galatians 1 and verse 10, if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. And so gospel preachers can't just say, well, now, which way is the wind blowing? And I'm going to preach the way that most of the brethren like so I can keep my job. Unfortunately, the tribe is increasing of that number. But Jesus didn't preach what was popular to the Pharisees or the Sadducees or even the common man. He preached what was the truth. The truth determined what he said. His apostles were of the same nature. That's why he selected them. And even John the Baptist, who was the forerunner introducing Jesus to the Jewish nation. You'll remember that in Luke chapter 7 and verse 24, that after the disciples of John had left because, and here's an interesting statement, John had been thrown into prison because he told Herod he couldn't have another man's wife, and he put him in prison, eventually had his head chopped off. But he sent disciples to Jesus and said, are you the Messiah, or do we look for another? But after he answered the question and they left, he asked the Jewish audience around him, he said, what did you go out in the wilderness for to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine garments? In other words, are you looking for a people pleaser, or are you looking for somebody who will stand staunch against the nation's wickedness and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand? And so John was looked on as an outsider, as someone different, and he was. But it was because he wanted people to wake up and to come out of their lethargy and to obey Jesus Christ and be baptized for the remission of their sins and repent. And so God sent people like that. So are we trying to please men or God in our religion? Ask yourself that question. Too many times elders will say, Well, if we make this decision and do this right thing, how many people are we going to lose? That's not how elders should think. Elders should think, let's do what's right. Let's make the right decision. We're leading the sheep, we're the shepherds, and we've got to do what Jesus Christ authorized, and whatever happens, happens. But sometimes we don't do that. Then there were certain Greeks who came. Look at chapter 12 and verse 20. This is a rather lengthy reading. It's not difficult, but it's interesting. There were certain Greeks among those who came up to worship at the feast. And they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Now that's interesting, because here are these Greeks, outsiders, coming to a Jewish feast, and they try to find a disciple of Jesus that is the most Greek-looking they can get. I think that's the significance of saying, well, they found this fella named Philip who was from Bethsaida. He looked a little more Gentile than the rest of them. So Philip came and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip told Jesus, and Jesus said, "The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain." And then he makes an application to us. "He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor." Well, now, what's that discussion all about? He says, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. While he was upon the earth, he was only sent to the Jewish people. And now he's about to end his earthly ministry, and he doesn't have time to talk to the Greeks or the Gentiles. That's coming later in the Great Commission. But you know how he calls his death? He says, it's time for the Son of Man to be glorified. Have you ever associated a murderous death with being glorified? Somebody gets murdered and they say, well, what happened to him? Oh, he was glorified. No, we don't say that. So how is it that Jesus could be glorified in his death? And the answer is, he is being glorified because he has finished the work which God gave him to do. And in doing God's will to the very last minute of his life, saying, Father, not my will, but thy will be done, and dying a horrible death on the cross, and yet being obedient to the very last moment, he was glorified, and God was glorified through him. And so you and I, by living our lives and being faithful unto death, are being glorified as well, and yet we're giving God the glory. Let your light so shine that men may see your good works and what? Glorify the Father who's in heaven. So again, as we preached last night, are you living a life where people see that and give God the glory? It's not about me or you, it's not about us, it's about God. But we can be glorified by the lives we live. And Jesus says, it's time for me to be glorified. And just imagine the emotional stress and strain on his mind as this goes about. And the good news is, the Greeks were not turned away, they were just postponed. Because in the Great Commission, after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and showing himself by many infallible proofs to have been raised from the dead, and just before he went to go at the right hand of the Father to sit on the throne forever and ever, he said to his disciples, go make disciples of all nations. What a momentous statement that was. And in the book of Acts, when the apostles go and convert Gentiles, they're glorifying God for the privilege of being a child of God. Paul in Ephesians 2 said, you who once were far off are now made near by the blood of Jesus Christ. And the Gentiles said, thank God. Because before they were without Christ, they were outside the commonwealth of Israel. They were strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Well, you take that condition and turn it around and say, welcome into the kingdom of Jesus Christ. You'd be glorifying God for it too. And so they could come to the gospel. Mark 16:15, go make disciples of all the creatures. Go preach the gospel to every creature. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. He who does not believe shall be condemned. But notice he said, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. Jesus said, if I die for the sins of the world, then those who believe in me and are washed in my blood will produce much fruit in the spiritual kingdom. We see that. That's an easy application. But do we see that he makes the point for us that we have to die spiritually? We have to be buried with Jesus Christ into his death so that we too can rise to walk in newness of life and produce much fruit? Look at chapter 12, verses 25 and 6. If you love your life, you will lose it. You'll lose your soul. You can't make this life all there is. You can't live selfishly for yourself from here, and then when you die, hope somehow you go to heaven. But he said, he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. He doesn't mean you have to hate yourself and despise yourself and look in the mirror and say, you miserable wretch. But what he's saying is you've got to sacrifice a portion of your life now in order to put Jesus Christ and his kingdom first in your life. There's a lot of sacrifices I made to become a gospel preacher. But it was a choice I made. It's not that I can glorify myself for it. Sometimes I wonder if I made the right choice. But there's a lot of sacrifice to that. One of them is you never live close to your own family. You move from place to place to place. No place is your home. People used to ask me, I'm a preacher's son too, and they say, well, Wayne, where are you from? And I'd say, you want the long version or the short version? And every once in a while, they'd say the long version. So I was born in Fort Scott, Kansas, moved to Medicine Lodge, then Bourbonus, Illinois, then Cache, Arkansas, Blytheville, Arkansas, Conway, Arkansas, where I graduated high school, went to college in Tampa, Florida, and now I'm living wherever I'm living. And they said, well, I didn't want to know all that. Well, you said, where are you from? And a lot of people who are in the military understand that too, right? We have any military people who have traveled all over the world. Some are here, I know. What a sacrifice they make, and it's a good one. We appreciate that. And so we have to realize that's a price you're willing to pay. And so that's part of what Jesus is talking about here. But in Romans chapter 6, verses 4 through 6, he describes it. We were buried with him by baptism into death, that Jesus, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should rise to walk in newness of life. But let's read on. If we have been united together in the likeness of his what? His death. We bury the old man of sin and self. If anyone will come after me, let him deny himself. Well, what do you do with self? You bury it in the waters of baptism. He said, then we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. We are free from prison and from Satan's clutches. And now we can live a life of righteousness and hope and glory by glorifying God in our bodies. And that's what this is all about. If we died with Christ, verse 8, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in its lust. And that's the Christian life in a nutshell. Paul explained that in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but it's not me that lives. It's Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It was a love between Paul and Christ, and he said, the love that I have for him, the love that he showed to me, is why I do what I do today. And that should be true of all of us as well. But you know, some believers refuse to go that far. I've tried to baptize people before, and they believe all the things they're supposed to believe. They're willing to repent to some degree, confess the name of Jesus, be baptized. But before they get to that point, they say, now what am I going to have to give up to become a Christian? And I think the better question is, what are you going to lose if you don't? Well, you see, they're counting the cost. It's a good question. But if you want to be a convenient Christian, which means I'll serve the Lord when everything's going good, and when the going gets rough, I'm going to leave, then that's not going to work. Because Jesus left us an example in verse 27 of John chapter 12. Jesus said, now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. The true test of faith for Jesus and for us is to do the thing that we think is very difficult or almost impossible, and yet by faith do it anyway. And that's what Jesus showed us here. Though he were a son, Hebrews 5, 8, and 9, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And we have to learn obedience to Christ the same way, by suffering for the cause of Christ. We're not looking for trouble, but Paul said, everyone who tries to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And so what's the end result of Jesus' death? Look at verses 31 through 33 of John chapter 12. He said, now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself. This he said, signifying by what death he would die. And he said, the world is judged in John 16 of sin because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and they see me no more. And of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. And so the losing side is Satan in this world and sin and death. It has a temporary pleasure, but it has a permanent loss. And so if you want to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, then you can be eternally lost. If you want to sacrifice some of those pleasures now to be eternally saved, it's worth the price. The world is the rebellious, sinful followers of Satan who follow the course of this world, Paul said in Ephesians 2 and verse 2. And John said in 1 John 5:19, we know that the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. Remember that, because you and I are Christians in an outpost in a very hostile world to true Christianity. But then we come to a valid objection that we find here in chapter 12, verses 35 and 6 of John. And that objection was, the people said, we've heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this man? They knew that language was saying that Jesus was going to die, and they said the Messiah of the Old Testament is going to live forever. Well, the answer was, by the death, burial, and resurrection of the dead, Jesus is the first one to be resurrected from the dead. Are you listening? Not the first one to be resurrected from the dead, but the first one to be resurrected from the dead, never to die again. Poor Lazarus had to die twice. But Jesus died once and lives forevermore. So they don't understand that. So Jesus warns them in verses 35 and 6. And basically he's saying, if you believe in me, then keep walking in that faith. In John 12 and verse 35, beginning, he said, a little while longer the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. You know, ladies and gentlemen, especially young people, the Christian life is a constant walk. You never stop to rest. It's like riding a bicycle uphill. You're either pedaling uphill or you're going to fall over. There's nothing in between. And so Jesus said, with what light you have now, walk in that light and keep walking that light, because if you walk in the light, it gets brighter. If you stop walking the light, then darkness overtakes you. And so keep that in mind. He said in verse 36, while you have the light, believe in the light that you may become sons of light. These things Jesus spoke and departed and was hidden from them. So he goes and disappears to kind of show them what he means. So if you believe tonight that Jesus Christ is Son of God and you're willing to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him, then walk in the light and keep on walking the light. True faith is developed not overnight, but over a journey between now and the time that you die. Walk in the light, and God will give you more light. True faith is developed. And in our conclusion tonight, we see why people don't believe. Look at verse 37. Although he had done so many signs before them, they did not believe in him, that the word of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spoke, Lord, who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore they could not believe, because Isaiah said again, He has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they should see with their eyes, understand with their hearts, and turn so that I should heal them. These things Isaiah said when he saw his glory and spoke of him. You know how God blinds the eyes of people and hardens the heart? By giving them a message they don't want to hear. If you want an earthly kingdom, he gives you a spiritual kingdom. If you want an earthly king, he gives you a spiritual king. If you want to save your life, he says, no, let's save your soul. If you don't enjoy the passing pleasures of sin here on this earth, he says, how about forsaking that and enjoy eternal life forever and ever? And so the message causes them to be hardened in heart, to turn away. And I remember a statement that is so true of the gospel that I heard a long time ago, and it says this, the same sun that melts butter hardens clay. So the sun is not the problem. It is, what are you made of? Are you made of material that hardens the more it hears the truth and turns away? You say, it's too heavy a price to be paid. I want to enjoy here and now. I don't know if eternal life is there. Or do you want to let the Word of God melt your heart like the sun melts butter and come forward and confess your sins, tears streaming down your face, say, I've shamed God in heaven. I'm no longer to be worthy to be called a child of God. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me in the blood of Christ as I'm baptized for the remission of my sins. And I want to arise in a new life and start all over again. I want to glorify Jesus in my body and in my minds, which are now His. So keep that thought in mind. Everyone will be judged by the New Testament they've rejected, because right here in John 12, it says people don't fail to believe because of a lack of evidence. It's rather because they have a sin-filled heart, or they have a fun-loving, growth-stunted mindset, or they are full of hatred and envy like the chief priests and the Pharisees, or they're materialistic seekers who want to have heaven on earth, or they want to please men like the certain rulers did. You'll be judged, and I'll be judged, by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of Jesus Christ. But tonight, that word that will judge you and condemn you if you reject it is the same word that will save you and glorify you if you'll obey it. And so, as a good friend of mine and the Fiat family, Brother Leon Odom, used to say, brethren, it's now decision time. And at every invitation song, we decide, yes, I'll follow Jesus, or no, I'm going to wait a while. Don't wait till it's too late. Jesus Christ said, the word that I've spoken, the same shall judge in the last day. So if you need to obey the Lord, He loves you. He cares for you. He wants to build you up. Resist the devil, he'll flee from you. Draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hearts, you sinners, and purify your minds, you double-minded. And come accept Jesus Christ while we stand and sing.